Good morning, my pretty little puppets. I hope everyone's well. You join me in the St. Catherine's dock. You'll join me after the tour of the Andalucía for an earlier morning tour of St. Catherine's dock, which will of course take in the dock's history. We go over towards Tower Bridge and a macabre little piece of history known as Dead Man's Hole. So that's an interesting bit. But the Andalucía is our main suspect for today. We're going to get some exterior views and then I'll give you some background information on this beautiful ship. Replica. That's fascinating. I'm looking forward to going on board this one. Hopefully filming is allowed. As I say, we'll get some exterior views of the ship. This is not something you see every day in London, as I say in my tour of St. Catherine's Dock. See its cannons on board. On the gun deck. And ports. That's what sank the Mary Rose, they think, the gun ports or cannon ports, whatever you want to call them, being open when the ship listed and water was taken on board. On the rigging. This area is a fascinating little gem in itself. Lots of history. We get a good walk around the dock. It's a two-parter because there's a lot to it, this place. You have the dock here, of course. Then where Thames meets St. Catherine's dock. A little wander along that, the foreshore of the Thames, over to Dead Man's Hole at Tower Bridge, which is a morbid, macabre little piece of history, so right up my alley. Galleon Andalucía, Sevilla. And of course, the Virgin Mary. And when she's at sea at night, that's her light. Mustn't it be fascinating to sail on board something like this? You'll join me just over that way and we'll get some more views. Here we are on the opposite side of the marina or the dock. Now for a little background information on the Andalucía. So you'll join me for that and then we'll discuss some of the areas on the ship where we'll be going. Pause to read those descriptions if you want to. And then at 12 o'clock, fingers crossed if they allow filming and photography on board, you'll join me on board. If not, then you've just got better exterior shots than I managed to get when she was coming in. So, fingers crossed and hopefully you'll join me on board at 12 o'clock. We are on board.
Mm-hmm.
The galleon, 17th century Spanish galleon replica, during a period longer than 3 centuries to the 16th to 18th century, galleons were the boats that took the lead role in the trade and cultural routes named in the Indies fleets. These were the longest routes in length, also lasted longer than any other in navigation history. El Galleon was built during 2009 to 2010 by Fundación Neo Victoria, designed and developed by Indiquio Fernandez Vial at the Puerta Umbria shipyard in Huelva, in Spain. The boat was launched on November the 30th, 2009. Then the masts were added at the beginning of 2010. El Galleon has covered more than 35,000 nautical miles between 2010 and 2013 along the world's largest seas and oceans, visiting ports in 4 continents, participating in many cultural projects. El Galleon has sailed across the Pacific, the Indian and Atlantic Oceans, as well as the Mediterranean Sea, the Red Sea and Southern China Sea, the Aegean Sea, the Bosporus Strait, the Caribbean Sea. So far, visitors have been able to step on her decks in almost 50 ports all over the world. So, our information was nicely covered for us. So what we'll do is we'll start up here first. This is the quarterdeck. Wheel chart room with 2 cabins for captain and pilot. Mizzen mast with 26.5 meters length of keel. The poop deck. The highest deck, with the stern lantern used to communication between the galleon and the fleet during the night. It's cordoned off at the moment, so hopefully it will be open. We hope. Well, it's not every day that you see something like this, I must admit. Compass is in there, look. And this is in the shape of a cross, nice, look. My goodness, you would have to have a head for heights to climb up there, wouldn't you?
Lupo, 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 lupo.
Era used by officers back in the days. Four cabins, two bathrooms, an admiral's room with two with historical furniture. The Spanish galleons. Tiny little cabin, look, with its bed. Oops. Temper City Council commendation. The Admiral's room. The room for exclusive use by the authorities. The furniture has been carefully reproduced in detail following graphic representations from the era of furniture used by Spanish galleons. The windows on the stern provide access to the balcony with painting of the Virgin Mary by ships that sought divine protection. Oh, that's the downstairs area. That looks interesting. We should cover that in a minute. She's beautifully reproduced, isn't she? Oh look, there's one for that'll interest Chris. Oh, and after our recent series on Chris's page ancestors. Blocks and tackles. maker. I think, and I could be totally wrong, do forgive me if I am wrong, that this is called the capstan, I think. My nautical knowledge is literally zero. Foremast, 34 metres in length, to the keel. Manoeuvring capstan, manoeuvring capstan, bell and two iron anchors, 2,200 pounds weight each. Wow, look at that. That would not want to fall on you, would you? Someone's note, a post-it note for jobs to be done. Oops, my wire unplugged itself. I know it is that's someone's to-do post-it note, yes, we've all got those, I think, haven't we, yeah. Let's cheer everyone up, the to-do post-it note. Foremast, part of the ship, which holds the bowsprit, mast, and all its ropes and rigging.
Hey buddy. Yeah. Looks like a pirate. Looks like a pirate.
Sorry for any sudden movements, obviously this is a really, really busy location, so... Andalucía, 2009. And I think we'll go downstairs. Oh, bly. There's a staple of my nan, I'd say. Entrada. Entrance. Oh, wow. This is fascinating. Kid in a candy's dormitory for me, this. Night time. Night fell, and the only activity on board was that of the watchman. The officials withdrew to their chambers, and the rest of the men slept in hammocks that hung on the artillery deck. The official on call revised the ship and made sure that the crew were at their posts. The cabin boy lit the light at the binnacle and turned off the fire in the oven. Silence flooded the ship, broken only by prayer of the cabin boy on each turn of the stand of the sand timer, which the sailors responded to in order to show they were not asleep. Sorry. This is here until the 8th of September, so if you can get tickets to book or go on board, if you haven't done so already, I suggest you do so. Probably going to be a several parter because there's quite a lot to it, a lot more than I thought. Hygiene and illness. The overcrowded ships of men with live animals, lice, fleas and rats, and the lack of drinking water meant that hygiene was visibly lacking. Frequently they suffered diseases such as the dreaded and deadly scurvy. Health, which was totally precarious, was in the hands of surgeons and barbers who could barely stitch wounds or perform a bloodletting. The main food on board was pound cake, a kind of cookie prepared with thick flour, usually boiled twice. Crew and passengers would eat them rotten, wet, full of worms, and on many occasions. Legumes, rice, flour, bacon, fish, salted meat, cheese, wine completed their diet. The only fresh foods available on board were the fish and some live animals. High temperatures and dampness would spoil fruit and vegetables within a short time. Water decomposed after 20 to 30 days of sailing, and then it was not fit for human consumption. Approximate amount of food loaded into a 500-ton galleon for a 90 days long navigation. Pound cakes, £31,000. Wine, 5,350 gallons. Rice, £1,250. Chickpeas, £1,250. Bacon, cured beef, £4,800. Olive oil, £440. Vinegar, £1,000. Cheese, £760. And cod, £2,275. Oh. It's in Spanish. That's all right. One bit's in English and the other's in Spanish. This is fantastic, very enjoyable. Bread and wine, table set, food ready. The main maintenance for the crew. Yeah, the main maintenance for the crew consisted of wine, bisotto, twice baked bread, another were vegetables and fruit, but these soon rotted and the food became pulses, rice, flour, salted fish and meat, cheese and nuts. The food was prepared on a wood-burning stove located on the main deck, which was carefully monitored to avoid any fire on board. The young cabin boys announced the meals by calling to the rest of the crew, warning, "He who does not come won't eat." Very interesting. Galleon. Navigation in their time. The galleons were the vessels used by Spaniards for their maritime expeditions and trade between Spain, America, and the Philippines from the 16th to the 18th centuries. Having an innovative design, in their time the galleons were armed merchant ships whose capacity ranged from 500 to 1,200 tons, while their lengths varied from 130 to 195 foot. They were designed to cross great oceans with the maximum efficiency. Crew and passengers. Generally more than 150 people sailed on each galleon. The average number of crew members on a 550-ton galleon was usually between 60 to 70 people. Crew members, passengers, women and kids, sometimes accompanied by live animals. Except the officers, they slept in coys and carried boxes or ranchos with their few belongings. Each person travelled aboard a galleon had just 1.8 square yards of habitable space. The art of caulking. That's this, what's in between these boards, caulking. My eyesight's appalling. This is about... It's about the work on board planks of the ship's frame to seal the joints, make it as watertight as possible, and to prevent leakage. It involves inserting a mixture of hemp fibre soaked in tar between two planks and a wooden hull. Master caulkers would insert two or three strands of oakum between the planks of the newly built ships. The timbers of the ships had already sailed. On the other hand, were dirty and pitted, and the surface of the planks and the hull's bottoms were charred using brushwood and very small pieces of wood to remove parasites. Next they were caulked, and the timbers were then coated with very hot tallow, which allowed the substance to better penetrate the grains. Navigation instruments. The great challenge of the oceanic crossings on the ships was to calculate the position of the ships on the sea to follow the course traced out and to avoid dangers when approaching an unknown coast. The mariner's compass, quadrant, astrolabe, sand timer, lead line and log were the navigational instruments used on the Spanish galleons. Thank you. Galleon. It is a replica of the type of vessel used by the Spanish Crown for maritime expeditions during the 16th to 18th centuries. Galleons were intended to explore, establish trade routes between Spain, America and Asia, and composed the called Fleet of the Indies. The first sailing around the world from 1519 to 1522 was the expedition that opened the great maritime routes that the galleons made from then on, connecting the world with an innovative design. At the time, the galleons were armed merchant vessels with tonnages of ranging from 500 to 1,200 tons, whereas their lengths overall ranged from 130 to 200 feet. They were designed to cross large oceans efficiently as possible. The galleons were the most universal Spanish ship, which played a lead role in commercial and cultural relationships during more than three centuries to the 16th to 18th. Between Europe, America and Asia, they formed convoys of more than 30 galleons, which annually sailed from Seville in Spain to America, Mexico and Panama, where they linked up with other great commercial routes that extended the navigation of the Pacific Ocean. The Manila Galleon route, the China route, that linked Manila to Acapulco and brought the rich goods from the Far East to Spain, where Western civilizations. Spanish galleons played the leading role on the longest in the time and length maritime route of the history of navigation during the centuries, during three centuries. And you're now joining me for part two. Welcome back. Dreams and fears. Despite the hard conditions that life imposed on board these ships, thousands of people embarked on these long ocean crossings, putting their lives in danger. Some of them made sea a way of life. The majority were seeking new opportunities. Some others just went for the wealth or the business. Thousands of dreams sailed aboard these galleons to pursue new opportunities and a better future. Here she is, look. For the sail. Danger, storms and pirates. Storms, leaks, ships wrecks, disease, starvation, pirate attacks constantly put the life of the crew. The Atlantic Ocean is rife with hurricanes and gales. I'm afraid you may have to pause to read this. Shifts at sea. The day was divided into 6 4-hour shifts for the distribution of the sailing work, maintenance work and others related to the life on board. Every shift was directed by one of the ship's officials, the pilot, the commander, the boatswain, with a third of the sailors, apprentices and cabin boys. Cannons, 5 cannons on each side, fired cast iron balls weighing 8 pounds. With a maximum range of 150 metres. These galleons were merchant ships that sailed in convoys escorted by navy ships, but even so, they had cannons for their own defence.
Over to kind of all true that we're going.
Thank you, you
all. Well, yeah, if I go so close.
Welcome on the artillery deck. As you can see, there are a lot of cannons here, that's why it's called the artillery deck. But this would be much more. All the crew would sleep here in the hammocks you can see behind you. They would eat here on the tables behind you. And they would work here, they would rest here. All the life of the sailors would be either on this deck or on the top decks. And this would normally be one big deck with hundreds. There would be 150 sailors on a ship like this. That would be very crowded here. There would be three classes. No, wait, you guys are 25, so there would be six classes. 50 with a top of you, right?
Oh. It's the size of us. There are 25 kids.
Yeah, that's the total. So there will be a lot of people here. I will answer the questions later.
Listening, please. Well done to Elsie.
Anybody know what this is? No? Do you know?
Now, can I go down the stairs? Into the bowels of the ship. Oh, sorry. Oh dear. In the 15th century, the sailors from the coast of Andalusia launched themselves into the oceans in an unprecedented exploratory race into history. In less than 300 years, they opened the ocean routes and changed the world forever. A new global era was beginning. Century of first sailing around the world. View century. The first sailing around the world is the closure of these ocean voyages starting from the Andalusian coasts, revolutionized human knowledge and created the foundations of the modern world by transforming the unknown oceans into communication channels. I'm sorry about the noise in the upper deck, but obviously this is only here for a certain amount of time, and we're not the only ones that want to see it. Well, accommodations have to be made. Noisy little bleeders. Thank God for that. I wanted to read this myself as well. Storms, leaks, shipwrecks, disease, starvation, or pirate attacks constantly put the lives of the crew. The Atlantic was rife with hurricanes and gales, which were weathered, leaving the bare poles, lowering the sails and yards, bilge pumping and lightening on the loads. Pirates and corsairs handed the Spanish routes through the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans for centuries, since sometimes the silver loaded on the galleons reached near 95% of the total load. Despite the constant threat of losses due to these attacks, minimal for the more than 250 years the Spanish galleons operated, so the West Indies fleet can be considered as one of the most successful naval operations in history. Shipwrecks were the highest price for the Spanish galleons during three centuries of sailing. The Gulf of Mexico, the Bahamas, the Channel, the Veracruz, Matanzas, Bermuda, the Bahamas, Azores, Cadiz. Their strong currents, fierce winds and threatening depths were amongst the most dangerous areas for navigation and the points where a larger number of shipwrecks occurred. Most of these galleons and their fabulous loads lie under the sea still today. The day was divided into 6 4-hour shifts for the distribution of sailing work, maintenance work, and others related to the life on board. Every shift was directed by one of the ship's officials, the pilot, the commander, and the boatswain, with a third of the sailors, apprentices, and cabin boys. Five cannons on each side, fired cast iron cannonballs weighing. Oh, we did this bit, didn't we? And the hold, I remember reading that bit. It was just a couple I just couldn't hear. And I don't suppose you could either. Sorry to sound like one of those grouchy, miserable old men, but fuck it. That's what I am, maybe.
Most of you just said that.
The fishing nets, look. I suppose fresh caught fish would have been one of their main resources, wouldn't it? Cast iron cannons with Iroko wood undercarriages each side, manoeuvring capstan and the access of the hold at the bow crew's quarters, 30 beds. Right, that is us done down here. Gonna pause us for a minute.
This is the last guy that made me
name. I'm afraid the highest deck is not accessible today. And that pretty much concludes our tour of the Andalucía. I hope you've all enjoyed. Just a little zoom round of the main deck before we go. And one thing I can't resist but to show you. Look. That is the last man who didn't pay his entrance fee. So yeah, hope you've all enjoyed. And that, ladies and gents, concludes our tour of the Andalucía. I hope you enjoyed. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you all on the next one, if you want, which will be the tour of St. Catherine's dock itself. So if that's your thing, rejoin me earlier in the day and we'll have a little tour of that. Hello ladies and gents, hope you're all well, and I've held off with putting the Andalucía on because I wanted to film this segment today on Columbus Day, so named after Christopher Columbus, because today is the day that she leaves. She's off today, off to pastures new. So we'll get some shots of her before she goes. The crew have just stowed her lifeboat on board now, so I assume that they're getting ready to leave soon. 11 o'clock she's due to leave. We get to view her from a different angle here. I don't envy her sailing out in this kind of weather, that's for sure. And you can see she's all her hatches or gun ports battened down and closed. And of course she is a sail ship. And on board we saw images of her in full sail, but she does have an onboard engine. That's how she manoeuvred through Tower Bridge and gets about and things like that when there's no wind. And here we view her from our starboard side. Such a beautiful ship. And it was handy because the information, the history and everything was really nicely included inside the ship forest, wasn't it, really? I am sorry about the noise, but this one was busy from the moment it opened until the moment she sold her last ticket, which was yesterday. And they did extend their stay because they were due to leave on the 6th, but obviously they wanted more people to see and enjoy the ship. And what better day to set sail for a Spanish galleon than on Columbus Day? So, the Andalucía, ladies and gentlemen. And here we get probably my favourite view of the Andalucía, with the ivory house behind me. That's enough of my ugly mush. You have to think back really to the great days of the Spanish galleons, and particularly in the case of England and Spanish galleons, the Spanish Armada. Very much what they would have looked like, those Spanish ships at the time. So, we've covered her from all angles now. And where the Andalucía was is now a whacking grey empty space. So to see her depart, see our final instalment. So on to the next video. If that's your thing and you can see her, turn around in here, go out through there and make her way off into the Thames. So if that's your thing, join me for the next video.